Hello everyone, I am very excited today to be behind the scenes in one of our incredible mammal stores. We are surrounded by dolphins and whales, and we've been finding out about a very interesting relationship between dolphins and pufferfish. So I'm chatting today with our curator, Richard Sabin. If you haven't seen that film, do watch it. It's very, very interesting. But Richard, we were finding out a little bit about whether, well, really the question of whether dolphins self-medicate. It's a really interesting question, isn't it? How much do we know about this?
Yeah, it's a subject actually that's been investigated for quite some time, quite a few decades, but there's more and more information coming to light, the more observations that are carried out. And when you think about dolphins, cetaceans generally, particularly the toothed cetaceans, so the dolphins and the porpoises, sperm whales, they're highly social animals. They're they form very strong bonds with each other. They're very curious, very inquisitive, highly complex patterns of behavior. So for me, really, it's no surprise that an organism that's so well adapted to its environment should actually have an ability or have developed an ability over millennia to self-medicate. There are plenty of things in the ocean that these animals can go to, and this is one of the things that, particularly in the Red Sea, scientists have been making observations on bottlenose dolphins there, who certainly appear to be, in some cases, actually locating particular types of coral species and sponges, queuing up and taking turns rubbing their bodies across the surfaces of those organisms. And of course, they then generate a mucus, and the mucus is known to contain medicinal properties, things that can help dolphins with things like skin irritations and other conditions. So it's not a surprise to me that this has really come to light, because there are probably lots of other aspects of their behavior which are going to be a complete surprise to us in the future. But it's not just dolphins. You know, we think that self-medication is something that humans have developed over millennia. Why shouldn't other species that have been around equally as long and are as at least as intelligent as humans have done the same thing? We know that things like primates, chimpanzees particularly, will target certain types of vegetation to help them with stomach conditions, digestive processes, internal parasites. There's incredible footage of elephants digging into rock faces in certain parts of Africa for the salt, to help with their salt content. There's lots and lots of things that are going on all over the world, and this is the thing that is really surprising us about these animal behaviours. You know, the things that we thought in the past made us uniquely human are slowly being eroded away as we find these behaviours in other animal species.
Yeah, absolutely. And yeah, we shouldn't be surprised if we find that we're not the only animals that self-medicate. Mm. It makes sense, doesn't
it? It really does, yeah.
We've got a fantastic specimen here. What are we looking at?
Yeah, this is actually the skull of a bottlenose dolphin from the Red Sea. So a part of the population, or one of the populations from that region, that is known to practice this self-medication. We occasionally, when we see these animals, bottlenose dolphins, around the British Isles, when they wash up as strandings, you can see a lot of lesions, lots of scars and things that they have on the surface of their skin. Some of those come from parasites, external parasites. Some of those are scars which are caused by interactions with other bottlenose dolphins, possibly orcas. But there are certainly conditions that these animals suffer from. You can see blistering, you can see healed areas. To live in such a vast aquatic environment with a wealth of resources and not use them, you know, again, I keep using this word surprising. Absolutely, it would be a surprise if these animals hadn't developed a form of knowledge. And the key thing is, you know, there's a direct transfer of knowledge from one generation to the next. We've heard about it with orcas particularly, where the older members of the pod, the females, actually stop reproducing. They go through a menopause, effectively. Mm. And that gives their offspring an opportunity to give birth, have offspring themselves that don't go into direct competition with their mothers and their aunts. But the mothers and the aunts and the grandmothers then spend the time teaching the youngsters how to hunt, where to go for the best fish, you know, all these different aspects of behavior. Incredibly complicated. So, yeah, there's still a lot to learn, a huge amount to learn. It's really exciting.
Yeah, definitely, definitely. And you know, we have these incredible collections here that can tell us so much. What sorts of things can we learn from skulls like this?
You know, as every year passes, I've been at the museum now for over 30 years, and some of the things that we're doing with these collections is like science fiction. Would have seemed like science fiction to me 30 years ago, but fairly routinely now, we can take samples from teeth, we can take samples of bone collagen. With the teeth, we can look at things like DNA, do population genetics, look at relationships of different groups of animals to each other. Look for unique determiners in the genes of these animals, haplotypes, which are specific to a particular region or a particular population. Those are key to identify groups that can then get special conservation recognition. That's really, really key. But the other thing is with the bone collagen, particularly, it's things like, we call them stable isotopes. And these are isotopes, things that get absorbed into your tissues, your soft tissues and your hard tissues, when you move around, when you eat, when you drink, and the things that you eat and drink and where you are on the planet, either on land or in the ocean, there are specific kinds of carbon and nitrogen and oxygen which get absorbed into your tissues. Now, we can read those pretty much like a book. And it gives us information from specimens like this about diet, about movement. To a certain extent, there are things also that we can learn from other parts of the animal's anatomy about the health of the animal and also the health of the environment that the animal was living in. So with every few years that passes, these collections become more and more scientifically valuable to us.
So much fantastic work going on, and thank you so much for showing us around today. It's been brilliant. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you so much for watching. We hope you enjoyed that. If you did, give us a like and remember to subscribe, and you can keep up to date with all of our latest content.